Hi guys! As you can see, Yaboy talks more in his YouTube videos now, cause I have more time to record. Anyway, before getting to the reason why you guys clicked on this video, aka the cult ending, I want to show you my Damien Bloodmarch cosplay, and why I like him. I liked Damien from the start. He's interested in art, history, nature, and also, he's a body positive and androgynous trans guy, just like me. He said he wears binders and he's also like 40. Therefore, he didn't have any sex change surgeries until this age, so he's okay with his body. I personally want a complete sex change with functional organs, but at the same time, I'm aware that my brain wiring, not my carcass, makes me man enough. Trans people are valid in any shape or form. Simply by existing, that's it. Bonus points for Damien for being aware of it and also for not being a walking stereotype. He's genuinely nice and a good representation for us trans people. Game Grumps created a great and interesting character. I wish we had more LGBT characters that aren't walking stereotypes. I may be a little late, as the game is from 2017, but I have to say something about the cult ending, aka the one with an evil Joseph roping people up and then killing them in his dungeon. In short, this is a secret ending that you get only after finishing the whole game with all the deads. You're dating Joseph, and him and your character get stuck on his yacht. After that, your dead Sona wakes up tied up in a dungeon, and Joseph appears in a priest robe. This one has a different voice. His name is Joseph Cult, not only Joseph this time, and this is an evil version of him. He tells Dead Sona that he lures couples into divorce and then kills them in order to feed the demon with their souls. A demon that will return to life after he eats enough souls, I guess. And also Joseph Cult can read Dead Sona's mind. Then Mary appears and sets Dead Sona free. He runs without knowing where he is, for how long he has been running, and if there's any exit. He feels degraded, both physically and mentally, and starts losing his mind. Then he opens the door and wakes up with Amanda in front of him, but she behaves weirdly. She tells Dead Sona a lot of things that aren't true. Also, there are glitches. At some point, you can see Amanda as a demon with complete black eyes. She doesn't want to answer when her birthday is, and then Dead Sona gets back in the dungeon. Mary appears and stabs Joseph, and his kids are demons with black eyes too, and they eat him. Here Joseph says to Mary, "See you in your nightmares." Dead Sona wakes up again with his daughter that knows her birthday now. Mary is there too somehow, and the detective tells Dead Sona that he's investigating what's happening in the city, as his wife also mysteriously disappeared. Now I tell you why I think this was all a dream. This was a dark alternative universe of Dream Daddy made for Halloween. This game is made of a lot of alternative universes in general, so there's no official true story. You pick which dead to date, and based on how you play, you get the good end or the friend zone end. And you can get a good or bad ending for Amanda too, based on how you treat her. It's all open. No version is the official one. The cult ending is made to be scary and confusing on purpose. With all of the glitches, Amanda and the kids being demons with black eyes, the fact that Dead Sona is helpless, like people usually are in a nightmare, you can see it's made especially for Halloween. The purpose of the game, Dream Daddy itself, isn't to be horror. So here's what I think the ending actually is. A nightmare resulted from Dead Sona's paranoia. Let's analyze Dead Sona a little. He's afraid to socialize, not that he doesn't like it, he's straight up afraid. He's even afraid to make eye contact with other people. He wants to spend his life inside, and the most important, He's overprotective to Amanda, even though she's already an adult. He starts having paranoid thoughts even when she goes out with her friends or when she's a little late. And this kind of nightmares with making up the worst scenarios in your mind is like subconsciously releasing the tension caused by paranoia. All of this being accentuated by moving in a different city, having a social life for once, and your daughter going to college, far away from you. I personally had some very traumatic dreams myself, and the first period in college in a completely new environment was very difficult for me. Those nightmares of mine were somehow related to the things that triggered my paranoia when I was awake, but with the worst scenarios possible. Back to the game, Joseph was really weird from the beginning, and his kids too. Just look what kind of games they play. And Mary, Joseph's wife, gets drunk and hooks up with guys at the bar. So clearly there are problems in that family. And of course Dedsona subconsciously targeted them and imagined the worst scenarios about them. Scenarios that were consciously repressed and then subconsciously released through a dream. A nightmare, more exactly. You get Nightmare Daddy for Halloween. Nightmare Daddy that only haunts you in your nightmares. In the game, there are some other creepy weird things as well. This game is not only fluffy unicorns and this kind of dreamy shit as it seems. It's rather realistic. So I guess the developers are into psychology and psychological horror too. And they wanted to spice the game a little. I mean, all of the characters seem to have mental or emotional problems at some degree. Dedsona is overprotective because his father was an absent one, Amanda was raised in a bubble by him, and most of the time, overprotected kids develop paranoid tendencies. Craig used to overwork himself in order to take care of his girls and of himself because he felt terribly guilty and how neglectful he was back in college. Joseph also feels guilty for his past, and he has big problems in his marriage. Matt just couldn't practice his passion again after his wife's death. Damien literally screamed when the lights went off at the cinema. This is the behavior of someone traumatized, not only the behavior of someone scared by a movie. A horror movie. So this is literally the purpose of a horror movie, to get scared. Also, both Damien and Hugo had problems with their hidden side, to say so, and with their sons. Even Lucien, the son of Damien, said that Damien went through a lot. And therefore, Lucien went through a lot as well. In Damien's route, Ernest finally calls Hugo dead, and Hugo tells Dedsona that the dog helped his son to become a better person. And about Robert and his tattoo being the same as the cult symbol, I guess it's actually just a boat steering wheel, that again was interpreted as the worst thing possible in Dedsona's nightmare. I guess Robert was in a relationship with Joseph or that they were good friends. Joseph has an anchor tattoo. So maybe they got matching tattoos and then separated. And Robert doesn't really like Joseph anymore, but instead he's friends with his wife Mary, who admits at some point that she has a miserable relationship with Joseph. During Robert's route, Dedsona realizes that, in fact, Robert isn't as scary as he seems at first. He's just a normal man with lots of regrets. Turns out that he was neglecting his wife, his daughter, and now he hates himself. That's why he behaves weirdly, tells fake stories to freak people out and to keep them away from him, and also he drinks a lot. Robert, just like Craig and Joseph, regrets his past. But for him it was harder to move on because he messed up way worse than Craig. Dedsona even manages to see Robert's soft side, and even becomes overprotective with him too. Also, Robert himself is pretty much paranoid. So, Dedsona doesn't perceive Robert as the weirdest anymore. Dedsona realizes that Robert is a good guy, and this also brings good points to Mary and bad points to Joseph. Even if Dedsona doesn't really know that much about his relationship with Robert and Mary. And now his paranoid scenarios focus on Joseph. Joseph's and Robert's tattoos weren't the only things Dedsona made fake scenarios about. Joseph's book about ropes was also interpreted as the worst thing possible by Dedsona's nightmare. In reality, maybe Joseph likes some BDSM, and of course he won't admit it. He likes aggressive sex, but you can only find that in Joseph's route. In Craig's route, he was weird about it. If reading about ropes was for his boat, he won't behave weirdly about this. And that made Dedsona exaggerate again. And I think that Dedsona even thinks BDSM is dangerous or something. That's why he imagined a sex dungeon in his nightmare. A sex dungeon that even Joseph called somehow denied. Another thing about the aggressive sex and BDSM thing. Judging by the fanfiction he reads, Damien probably enjoys hardcore sex too. But in general, Damien is a shy guy, he's a sweetheart, everyone likes him, even Mary. He's always polite to everyone. So Dedsona doesn't see him as a dangerous individual. Now let's talk about the TV shows Dedsona likes. They imply a lot of exaggerated stuff in order to make them entertaining, like the detectives stereotypically wearing a coat and having a scar or something similar to make them more tough, just as in Dedsona's nightmare. But the characters don't look stereotypically in the game, Saul being the only one. So he was the result of Dedsona's imagination, shaped by those TV shows. Those TV shows, both brave people doing dangerous or very skillful things. And I bet Dedsona compares himself with them, and this makes him feel more fragile in front of his fake scenarios. Even if those TV shows aren't actually real, and Brian calls them fake as well, but Dedsona seems he doesn't want to accept it. Brian is like Dedsona's grasp of reality in the game, the reality that Dedsona is afraid to accept. I immediately thought of Brian saying how the fish in the restaurant is fake when I saw this fish on Joseph's wall. And I made a parallel between this. That's how I got my theory about Brian. Dedsona also talks to Hugo about wrestling being partially fake, but Dedsona wasn't into wrestling at the moment, so more probably he didn't and he won't think about it so much. He's used to wrestling being fake from the start, and his shows being real, and he considered them real for so long. And even if Brian already tells Dedsona that he knows better, even if Brian debunks the shows, Dedsona subconsciously still doesn't accept it. Because denying something new, it's like finding comfort in the things that you're used to. Because the unknown is dangerous for Dedsona. It's like his brain doesn't want to accept that reality is not as he thinks in general. He even feels more fragile and not capable to do anything in front of Brian. And he starts an argument with him. Like his conscious side argues with his unconscious side. But if you pick the option, be honest to yourself, Dedsona finally admits his unconscious side to the conscious one, accepts it, and tries to overcome it, with the help of Brian. The character of Brian is different from the other Deds, because Dedsona is usually the one that helps them with their struggles. With Brian, he's overcoming his own struggles. He knows how to spot lies and how to help people. Even if his little games are annoying for Dedsona at first, Brian knows how to work with people and on their development. That's why his daughter is so smart. I mean, Amanda is smart too, but due to being overprotected, she will probably not know how to make the right decisions in an emergency situation. Brian's route is one of my favorites in the game, but this route isn't the one that leads Dedsona to his paranoid nightmare about Joseph. Even if it was, and I mentioned this in one of my videos, paranoia doesn't just disappear after you start facing your fears. It takes time. It's hard to fight with paranoia. Doesn't matter if you consciously know the truth. You have to keep feeding the conscious part of yours. So, it would still be possible for Dedsona to have this nightmare in each of the routes. But he had this nightmare in the route focused on Joseph. And no, I don't think the cult ending is actually true in that Dedsona images Amanda and the kids as demons because Joseph drugged him or something. Amanda says that the yacht sinked. And Joseph is a sailor. He won't just sink his boat in real life. And the end also has glitches, which obviously won't exist in real life. Another reason why I think the cult ending is nothing but a Halloween extra is all of the reasons why Dedsona has this nightmare about Joseph are presented in each date with all the Deds. Meanwhile, in the actual game, you make your own story by picking one alternative universe that you like the most. I want some Demian, please. So, in order for the cult ending to be the official ending, you have to date all of the Deds in only one universe of the game, and not in separated universes, which is not how visual novels work. The cult ending is like you get the information from all of the dates, but you still follow only one and choose to date Joseph. In the actual game, the stories of the Deds are the same in any of the universes, but you can't date all the Deds at the same time, and then date Joseph, as the cult ending suggests. In the end, I think the whole cult ending was a psychological horror bonus made for Halloween, like an extra, out of the actual story of the game. Maybe you will say I'm projecting, but I relate a lot with some of the characters in this game. Also, Yaboy studied a lot of literature and psychology in high school, so I guess my analysis is pretty logical. This is my theory, guys. I'd like to know yours. Also, I took the screenshots from the YouTubers Father, Taka, Cinnamon Toast Ken, and Christine's second channel, Simply Not Logical. Yeah, I'm too broke to buy games, so I watch other YouTubers playing them. Moving on, thank you so much for watching and let me know your theories in the comments.